for the next section, Nemesis and the Expropriation of Death. It begins with two quotes from Illich, which define Nemesis. Classical Nemesis was punishment for the rash abuse of a privilege. Industrialized Nemesis is retribution for dutiful participation in society, end quote. That's the epigraph. As Peter Skrabanek writes, and I quote, "By supervising and minding them from birth to death, or even from before birth, the art of living and the art of dying, transmitted from generation to generation, were obliterated and lost," end quote, from Skrabanek. Illich observes that until the coming of the European paradigm that has since flooded the world with its monoculture, we could say, each distinct culture in history has been able to, this is a quote from Illich, who was a historian, set the myth, the rituals, the taboos, and the ethical standards needed to deal with the fragility of life, to explain the reason for pain, the dignity of the sick, and the role of dying or death. That's Ivan Illich. For Skrabanek, prior to what he calls, I quote, "the medicalization of death, the dying were more in control of their end than now." That's an interesting reflection from Skrabanek. To illustrate classical Nemesis, Illich gave us the image of Titanic suffering. For Illich, who himself suffered horribly, he had a, cancerous growth on his face, and one couldn't miss that. It's also to be seen in many of the photographs, but he refused treatment, largely actually to be able to write in the vineyard of the text, which is a wonderful achievement, but that means that he certainly knew about suffering. The term that he uses is that ananke, that's the Greek word for necessity, is part of the human condition, and that suffering would then be part of that. He thus reminds us that the Titan Prometheus, who was named for his overarching greed, his measureless ambition, of himself drew the envy of the gods, swift Nemesis, upon himself. By contrast, we are ourselves their form. We remember Aquinas's language, we remember the language of the book of Genesis. We are as the deity, which can only mean, if we attend to the lessons of the myth, as Illich argues, that owing to all our powers and our own comparably measureless ambitions, also like Prometheus, technical Nemesis comes hard upon the heels of, it is the backlash of progress. Paradoxically, Illich writes, it has spread as far and as wide as the franchise, schooling, mechanical acceleration, and medical care. Thus, for Illich, Nemesis is of two kinds, mythic and technical. Like Elul, Illich highlights the structural and endemic consequences of technical Nemesis, whereby, in concord with Heidegger, he argues that there is no fix. I quote, "The main source of pain, disability, and death is now an engineered, albeit non-intentional, harassment. The prevailing ailments, helplessness, and injustice are now the side effects of strategies for progress," end quote. Illich uses the mythic figure of Tantalus and the eternally elusive appetite for ambrosia, which elixir we may take as metaphorically as we like. In the Tantalus story, it's by definition a moving target, as a parable for medical modernity and defining the medical profession as what he calls, I quote, "a priesthood of Tantalus, promising the limitless riches that are part of myth and phantasmatic dream." If we think of what I elsewhere call the cargo cult of transhumanism, a certain techno-fetishism animates what Illich calls black magic. To translate his point for today, Illich's example in his own book was the first successful heart transplant. A DARPA conference held here in New York last summer, Biology is Technology, reported on the progress of the cultivation of human pig chimeras, that is, embryonic mosaics. I'm going to come back to that at the end, so I'm going to repeat that later, but talk of pig transplants hardly phases us. The digital hype of transhumanism calls for limitless hacking of the body towards the perfectionist ideal of accelerated evolution on and into an increasingly technologized trajectory, Moore's Law for Humanity 2.0, or more, it, no, humanity 2.0, 3.0, 5.0, no matter how limited this turns out to be. And the Tantalus Guild, priesthood of medicine, assuming our total devotion, that's why Illich's Black Magic Critique works to characterize it, promises nothing less than unlimited, I quote, medical improvement of human health, unlimited. As Illich continues to say, quote, the members of this guild pass themselves off as disciples of healing Asclepios, while in fact, they peddle ambrosia. People demand of them that life be improved, prolonged, rendered compatible with machines, and capable of surviving all modes of acceleration, distortion, and stress. End of that quote. For Illich, a priest who remained one until the end of his life, speaking in parables to doctors and to nurses for the sake of life's truth, a truth that of course includes what we do not like to speak of, and we don't need Heidegger or Leo Tolstoy, as Heidegger also refers to his Ivan Illich, that's a different Ivan Illich, the Russian lawyer judge who dies in Leo Tolstoy's short story, to identify this taboo topic as death. For Illich, what's relevant is the co-equivalent term, pharmakon, that is both cure and poison. And although true to his attention to the iatrogenic, Illich emphasizes both the dangers and the allures, the double bind of glamorizing prescription drugs, using the example of chloramphenicol, which was then marketed as a relatively harmless drug, prescribed in the US as US doctors tend to prescribe antibiotics to excess. For Illich, nota bene, and there are parallels with Lyme disease, doctors tend to notice only the side effects that are hard to miss, subtle things. Thalidomide, they notice, because as Illich says, it disfigures. Incontrovertibility works for us, and we have trouble with things that take time. Even our tests for product safety have to be black and white. Think the Dreyer's test, what doesn't kill you, so the pharmaceutical industry seems to suppose, echoing Conan the Barbarian's caricature of Nietzsche, might make you stronger. It might help. This is like when you have cancer signing up for a test protocol that may or may not help you sign on the dotted line. But slow poisons like chloramphenicol, still standard for eye infections, I was just prescribed a tube, are harder to notice. Thus, Illich points to the habit of doctors not, this is a quote, to attend to the side effects, especially when those are or can be, as he says, invisible. If today we substitute AZT for Illich's chloramphenicol, we can trace, as the 2013 film Dallas Buyers Club did do, a similar pattern. Invisibility in the case of side effects or patient complaints difficult to diagnose or resolve are also evident in debates concerning Lyme, as of other underdiagnosed diseases that persist, not unlike syphilis, as Ludwig Fleck discusses this in The Genesis and Development of a Scientific Fact, in occult and pleonastic forms, and which progress, this is probably the least discussed and most pernicious of details, over years in the body. Take a symptom like brain fog. What can that mean? Or merely joint pains or arthritis, both of which are normal concomitants of age. Generalized aches, flu-like symptoms, etc., all of which can be denied, all of which ascribe to malingering or otherwise discounted. Illich's nemesis is consequent to access to medicine. Increased medicalization, this is a quote, meaning statistically increasing levels of screening, including preventive care, treatment, hospitalization, go together not with reduced but increased costs, meaning both private and government expenditures, that's the quote, as well as, most ironically, as Illich also notes, an increased decline in life expectancy for American males aged 45 to 54. That was then. Pay more, get less, in what now seems the de rigueur bubble mechanism of today's multiply bailed out capitalist system. This particular nemesis effect, if only because it affects middle-aged white males, gets our attention and cannot be written off as a blip specific to Illich's mid-1970s era, as he then reported it, inasmuch as 8 months ago, the New York Times reported the findings of the Nobel Prize-winning Princeton economist Angus Deaton and his wife Anne Case. I'm just going to quote the title of the New York Times headline, "Death Rates Rising for Middle-Aged White Americans, Study Finds."